Hachette Audio presents The Shanghai Free Taxi, Journeys with the Hustlers and Rebels of the New China, written and read by Frank Langfitt.
A cast of characters in order of appearance. Chapter 1. Yang, my news assistant, a young man who helps me scheme up the Shanghai Free Taxi and accompanies me on road trips. Chen, a Shanghai pajama salesman who runs an underground church and moves his family to America to give his daughter a less stressful education. Chapters 2 and 3. Rocky, a farm boy turned Shanghai lawyer from Hubei province who I drive home for Chinese New Year. Charles, another passenger on the Chinese New Year road trip who works as a salesman in a Shanghai shipping parts factory and later becomes a news assistant for a European newspaper. Guo, Rocky's mother, who overcame political persecution during the Cultural Revolution. Ray, Rocky's older brother and a fellow Shanghai lawyer who studied in America. Chapter 4. Beer, a slippery salesman who tries to sell me a used car to serve as my free taxi. Amanda, a former finance worker who has lost her family fortune in a pyramid scheme. Fifi, a former schoolteacher and psychologist who is married to a Frenchman who lives in Paris. Chapter 5. Joanna, a human rights lawyer who engages a Shanghai cabbie in a democracy debate. Max, a hairstylist from the countryside who gives back by cutting the hair of elderly shut-ins for free. Chapter 6. Crystal, a Chinese-American NPR listener who enlists Mai and Yang's help to search for her little sister, who has gone missing in the mountains of southwestern China. Winnie, Crystal's little sister, a former prostitute who tries to reinvent herself as an independent businesswoman and then vanishes. Chapter 7. Sarah, a young woman from the provinces who I help move and who is trying to find her place amid the bright lights of Shanghai. Ashley, an investment banker and daughter of Communist Party officials who moves to America in search of political freedom months before the election of Donald Trump. Chapter 10. Gong, the wife of pajama salesman Chen, who sets up a home for her family in Greater Los Angeles. Jali, Gong and Chen's teenage daughter, who was born in China. Yingying, the couple's younger daughter, who was born in America. Chapter 1. Beginnings. Chen. In the summer of 1982, between my graduation from high school and the beginning of college, I began driving a taxi in and around Philadelphia. I started at a suburban company called Narberth Cab, which had a dispatch office in a basement grotto beneath an Italian restaurant. Because I was the newest and youngest driver, the dispatchers often stuck me with the worst cab in the fleet, my 1970s Dodge Dart. When I pulled up to apartment buildings, the tailpipe spewed clouds of gray exhaust and sent crowds scurrying. We called it the crop duster. Once the passengers stepped inside, though, the taxi became like a cozy corner bar. For a few miles or a long ride, customers talked about whatever was on their minds and what they really cared about: work, children, marriage, and their futures. For an aspiring journalist like me, it was ideal on-the-job training. My passengers often shared personal thoughts and feelings without fear of judgment, and occasionally, I saw them at their most vulnerable. I drove an elderly woman to a liquor store every few days to buy a bottle of vodka and hauled a middle-aged man home from a bar one afternoon and helped him up the stairs. One summer night, the dispatcher sent me to a house out on the main line. A young woman stood waiting in the doorway with two suitcases, but she wasn't heading to the airport. As I drove her to the home of a friend, she explained how her boyfriend had been so kind in the beginning. "I got sucked into this," she said, gesturing as we passed the spacious stone houses with white columns and freshly cut lawns. The relationship had soured, and she was determined to escape. As I pulled up to her friend's house, she wiped away her tears and thanked me for listening. Nearly three decades later, I prepared to head to Shanghai for my new job as one of National Public Radio's correspondents covering China. It was a challenging assignment. Because of the authoritarian political system and circumspect culture, it wasn't always easy to get Chinese people to speak openly. I flew into Shanghai one summer day in 2011 and boarded the city's magnetic levitation train, one of the world's fastest, with a top speed of 267 miles an hour. Gliding above magnetic rails, maglev as it's called, rocketed toward town at nearly 190 miles an hour, leaving the apartment blocks, cranes, canals, and farm fields outside little more than a blur. When we passed another train heading in the opposite direction, our carriage shook as if it had been struck by an earthquake. This was the impression the Communist Party wanted to leave with visitors. China was changing so fast, it felt like the tectonic plates were shifting beneath your feet. Maglev covered 18 miles in less than 8 minutes, but that was long enough to begin to see weaknesses beneath the impressive facade. Maglev, which had cost $1.2 billion, was already 7 years old and a white elephant. The seats were worn and most sat empty because the $6 ticket was too expensive and the train's route inconvenient. Maglev dropped passengers nearly 10 miles away from the city center. China had become the world's number two economy in record time, but only a small percentage of people had become genuinely wealthy. The quick train trip provided a revealing snapshot of China at the moment, a striking veneer with cracks just beneath the surface. The perception back in the West was different. Most Americans still thought China was on a tear. Our overlords is how comedian Jon Stewart referred to the country's leaders on The Daily Show. The reality, though, was more worrisome and complicated. China's staggering economic growth rates had slowed to a still enviable level above 6%, but the country's boom was over. Government corruption had metastasized. The Chinese now routinely referred to the last 10 years as a lost decade, because the government had done so little to address major problems such as air pollution and China's business model, which even party leaders acknowledge had run its course. This was my second tour of China. I'd worked as a newspaper correspondent in Beijing from 1997 to 2002. Upon my return to the country, I also noticed many encouraging changes in my years away. Though not yet rich, many Chinese were much more prosperous and sophisticated, and online speech was flourishing. I was surprised to find the party allowed a whirlwind of criticism, often targeting the government, to swirl around massive digital platforms, such as Sina Weibo, a microblog service considered the Twitter of China. In my first months in Shanghai, it became clear the Communist Party was losing the faith of its people and losing its way. After more than three decades of economic reform, rising living standards, and opening to the world, the globe's most populous country was at a crossroads. And something had to give. How would the party respond to the tremendous changes and rising expectations of its own people? Would it adapt and become more open, or revert to its authoritarian instincts? In 2011, it was anyone's guess. Shanghai, China's showcase city, seemed a good place to begin to search for answers. A mix of East and West, it was one of the world's largest cities, with 24 million people ranging from rice farmers to billionaires, and covered an area the size of the U.S. state of Delaware. It was also a study in contrasts, urban and rural, glittering and gritty, rich and poor, idiosyncratic, grandiose, outwardly confident, but inwardly insecure. I wanted to know what ordinary Chinese were thinking at this crucial moment and what mattered to them, but finding out would require a new strategy. Despite the relative freedom on the internet, many Chinese were still cautious about speaking their minds and would become even more so in the years to come. To try to understand Shanghai from the ground up, I settled on what had worked so many years earlier in my hometown of Philadelphia, a taxi cab. The idea seemed ludicrous, but logical. In a cab, no one else can hear what you say. What better way to encourage people who are naturally shy with reporters to speak candidly? I tried to replicate my experience in Philadelphia and went to local taxi companies asking for jobs. The bosses shook their heads and laughed. They told me, unlike in America, foreigners weren't allowed to drive cabs in China. So, in a city where people were constantly reinventing themselves, hatching new schemes, I came up with a novel business model, free cab rides in exchange for conversation. Roof lamps are banned on private cars in Shanghai, so my news assistant, Yang, had white magnetic signs made. One set of signs read, "Mian Fei, Ai Xin Che," or literally, "Free Loving Heart Taxi," which sounds better in Mandarin than it does in English. Another pair said, "Jiao Shanghai Peng Yao, Liao Shanghai Sheng Huo," or "Make Shanghai Friends, Chat About Shanghai Life." The biggest sign, draped over the hood, read, "Wo'ai Shanghai," or "I love Shanghai." Though my feelings about Shanghai were a bit more complicated, there was much I came to love about China's second city and its people. Shanghai was a visually astonishing mix of modern buildings that evoked Las Vegas and Tokyo, and colonial architecture reminiscent of London and France. Brimming with energy and drive, it operated on a scale that dwarfed Manhattan. Within blocks of where my family and I would settle stood two skyscrapers taller than the Empire State Building and a third Shanghai Tower that would exceed 2,000 feet when finished. I'd never lived in a more dynamic city with so much ambition and potential. As I pursued my taxi experiment, I worried no one would actually accept a ride, so I began cautiously and rented a Toyota Camry. I spent days getting up the nerve to go out driving while the sign sat rolled up in a duffel under my desk. One rainy Sunday night in June 2014, I headed out on the town, still worried that people might laugh when they saw my car. But like so much that was to follow, the reactions to the cab were as surprising as they were illuminating. After 15 minutes, I picked up a Chinese man in front of the Peace Cinema across from People's Park in the heart of the city and promptly got lost. My passenger had spent the past two decades in Tokyo and was visiting Shanghai as a tourist, so he was even more disoriented than I was. He gave me the address of his hotel, which I struggled to find using my GPS. After a series of wrong turns, I finally dropped him off within walking distance of where he was staying. I felt embarrassed by my incompetence, but my poor service didn't faze my passenger. He was just happy to chat with a foreigner and get a lift home. I found that when you offer something for free, people don't expect too much. When pedestrians saw my free taxi, they didn't laugh or scowl, but smiled, nodded knowingly, and gave me the thumbs up. They liked the idea that someone was helping strangers and asking for no more in return than a chance to talk and learn. Bargain hunters by nature, Shanghainese also recognized a good deal when they saw one. As for the state security agents who kept an eye on me because I was a foreign reporter, they knew about the free taxi but never bothered me. I later heard that one of the agents liked the radio stories the free taxi generated. Not everyone immediately grasped what I was doing. After filling up the tank one morning, I spotted an elderly couple standing in the rain and offered them a ride. They hopped in and sat silently in the back. Usually, my passengers were intensely curious and interviewed me in a wonderful reversal of the usual journalistic process. "Where are you from?" they'd ask. "Why are you doing this? Is this your full-time job?" I always explained I was a reporter. "Oh, do you need an assistant?" some would respond. And nearly every passenger asked this, "Is your wife Chinese?" The elderly couple, though, said almost nothing and directed me to a nearby hospital where they planned to pick up medicine.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.